Apple made things a little confusing with the 15-inch M2 MacBook Air. When you first look at it, $1,299 is an incredible value for a super thin, light, and powerful 15-inch MacBook. But once you start adding unified memory and internal storage, doesn't it make sense even for the everyday user to go with the 14-inch MacBook Pro? Let's talk about it. Also, I know the prices are different around the world, so let me know in the comment section where you're from and what the base model of each one costs where you live. Now, in terms of the overall shape, both laptops have the same boxy design, where the 15-inch MacBook Air looks like you took the 14-inch MacBook Pro and just kind of smushed it down. The MacBook Air has a larger footprint, while the MacBook Pro weighs about 0.2 pounds or 90 grams more, and it's noticeably thicker. Like, essentially, the MacBook Air is the same height as the base of the MacBook Pro. In terms of practical portability, it's pretty close to a tie, unless your bag just isn't big enough to physically fit the 15-inch Air. At the same time, I've used both of these since they were released, and the MacBook Air just feels like I'm using an ultralight MacBook. I know that because the weight is so close, it shouldn't really feel that different, but I can just tell you, for me, it really does. Now, when we look at the ports, we start seeing some critical differences in terms of performance and user experience. So the MacBook Air has two Thunderbolt 3 / USB 4 ports and a MagSafe port on the left side, then a 3.5 millimeter headphone jack on the right. The MacBook Pro comes with two Thunderbolt 4 ports, a MagSafe port, and a 3.5 millimeter headphone jack on the left, then another Thunderbolt port, an HDMI port, and an SDXC card reader on the right. In terms of data transfer speeds, both MacBooks have ports that support up to 40 gigabits per second. While the MacBook Pro has one additional port, the overwhelming majority of typical users can get by with two ports, especially since there's a MagSafe port for charging. Now, having said that, with the MacBook Air, all three ports are on the left side, so you can only charge the MacBook or connect accessories from one side. The MacBook Pro has ports on both sides, so when you're traveling, when you're out at a coffee shop, or even when you're just around the house, you have more convenient access. Now, on top of that, if you wanted to connect an HDMI display or you needed a card reader, you don't need any additional adapters or a hub with the MacBook Pro. Another super important difference is external display support. The MacBook Air supports a single external display with up to 6K 60 Hertz. With the MacBook Pro, if you get the M2 Pro chip, you get support for two 6K 60 Hertz displays. If you get the M2 Max chip, then you can go up to three 6K 60 Hertz displays and an additional 4K 144 Hertz display. If you've seen my main workstation, you know that I love multiple displays, and having the ability to connect even just two displays to the 14-inch M2 MacBook Pro can really improve your productivity and allows you to essentially have the MacBook Pro drive a desktop-like system both at home and in the office. Side note, if you want to see how to connect three displays to any M1 or M2 MacBook, watch this video. Now, speaking of displays, let's actually look at the built-in displays. We're getting a 15.3-inch display on the MacBook Air versus 14.2 on the MacBook Pro. So, of course, the MacBook Air is larger, but surprisingly, the MacBook Pro has thinner bezels. In terms of the actual display itself, it's an easy win for the Liquid Retina XDR display on the MacBook Pro. Don't get me wrong, the 15-inch display on the Air is very nice, but the MacBook Pro display is super sharp, the colors look amazingly crisp, and because it's a mini LED display versus LCD on the MacBook Air, we're getting a lot more dimming zones with darker blacks. Now, even though the MacBook Pro is smaller, it has a higher resolution, but what's super interesting is that because of how scaling is handled, you actually see more of a web page on the MacBook Air than the MacBook Pro. Now, while both displays have 500 nits max brightness for SDR content, the MacBook Pro goes up to 1000 nits of sustained full screen brightness and then 1600 nits peak brightness for HDR content. Now, if all you do is watch SDR content, then it's not a major difference, but more and more content is being created in HDR, and then the difference is noticeable. Now, both displays are P3 displays with support for 1 billion colors, which is great, but the MacBook Air has a 60 Hertz display and the MacBook Pro has ProMotion. This is Apple's adaptive refresh rate of up to 120 Hertz. And essentially, depending on what you're doing, the display can go from 24 Hertz all the way up to 120 Hertz in order to optimize the user experience and maximize battery life. Now, moving on to the keyboard and trackpad, We're getting the same keyboard on both devices. It's one of the best keyboards that I've used on any laptop, and I have nothing but good things to say about it. It's comfortable to type on, the keys have a good amount of bounce back, we're getting a full height row of function keys, and there's a Touch ID button for biometric authentication. As far as trackpad, Apple might make the best trackpad on the market. It's super responsive, it's accurate, you can click anywhere, and the only noticeable difference is that the 15-inch MacBook Air has a larger version. Now, the one other advantage that I'll give the MacBook Air is that it's a little more comfortable to type on because of the larger palm rest assembly and the thinner base. As far as cameras, both MacBooks use Apple's newer 1080p camera, which works really well for video calls. In both cases, we have a notch, and I feel like I always have to add this disclaimer. Yes, I wish it wasn't there if it means that I didn't have to give up on the thin bezels, which just isn't possible with the current camera module. No, it doesn't bother me, and no, it doesn't interfere with any of the ways that I use any of the MacBooks that have a notch. And the one feature that I wish we got with it was Face ID. Now, when we look at the speaker systems, both MacBooks have a 6-speaker sound system with force canceling woofers. With the MacBook Air, the speakers are hidden in the hinge. And with the MacBook Pro, we see the more typical speaker grills on each side of the keyboard. Now, Apple calls the sound system on the MacBook Pro high fidelity. And in this case, it's not just marketing talk. The speakers on the MacBook Air are surprisingly good, especially considering that you really have to look hard to find them, but they can't compete with the MacBook Pro sound system in terms of quality. The audio is fuller on the MacBook Pro, it's warmer, it has more presence to it. So if you're looking to use the speakers on your MacBook, the 14-inch is the way to go. Now let's talk a little about processing power. And I say a little because if you're looking for the more powerful machine, obviously, you know that's the MacBook Pro, whether you go with the M2 Pro or the M2 Max. And that's because of the additional CPU and GPU cores. But the MacBook Air has plenty of power for the vast majority of users. Since the foundation of all three chip variations is the same, single core performance is virtually identical. When we look at multi-core performance, as you'd expect, the MacBook Pro comes out ahead, and by how much really depends on which configuration of the MacBook Pro you go with. But of course, the price starts going up fairly quickly, so let's focus on the base model. For GPU performance, again, you'd expect the MacBook Pro to come out ahead, and it does. Another advantage we see with the MacBook Pro has to do with sustained performance. Because it has an active cooling system, or fans, when you push the system and it starts to heat up, the MacBook Pro can just turn the fans on, cool the system down, and then maintain the same level of performance. And we can see that pushing the system to 100% for 30 minutes for getting the same performance as the much shorter baseline test. With the MacBook Air, which has no fan, the system has to throttle performance in order to cool down, and we're seeing about a 7.5% drop in performance. So here's how I would look at it. The typical user isn't pushing their MacBook to the limit for that long on a regular basis. And even if they do every once in a while, assuming that the baseline performance of the MacBook Air is enough for them, it's only a slight drop on very rare occasions. Now, if you regularly batch hundreds of high-res photos in Lightroom, if you're working with super demanding video files and you're rendering large video projects, or if you're using 3D applications, then you'll notice upwards of 2 to 5 times improved performance on the MacBook Pro, but that user is already likely to know that they're better off with a MacBook Pro. In addition to this improved performance, the MacBook Pro has twice the memory bandwidth, and there's an important difference when it comes to unified memory. The base MacBook Air comes with 8 GB and it can be upgraded to 16 or 24. The MacBook Pro starts out at 16 and can be upgraded to 32, 64, or 96 GB. And I'll come back to this in just a minute, but let's talk about SSD speeds and battery life. So as far as SSD speeds, we're seeing another difference, but probably not the one that you would expect. The 256 GB version of the MacBook Air comes with significantly slower SSD speeds than the larger sizes. And in either cases, the MacBook Pro comes with an even faster SSD. But how does this actually impact data transfer? So we copied 2 GB from a super fast external SSD and then found that the 256 GB MacBook Air finished in 15.02 seconds, the 512 GB in 8.89, and then the MacBook Pro in 8.23. MacBook Pro has a slightly larger battery at 70 watt hours versus 66.5 on the MacBook Air. But while both are rated for 18 hours of video playback, the MacBook Air is rated for 15 hours of wireless web surfing versus only 12 on the MacBook Pro. In my daily use with both, I only really have to charge them either every other day or every 3 days, but the actual battery life depends on what I'm doing. If I'm only using the MacBook for very light use, if I'm surfing the web, doing email, watching videos, and working with basic documents, the MacBook Air definitely lasts longer. But if I'm working in Lightroom, in Premiere Pro, or Final Cut Pro, and especially if I'm exporting images or rendering video, then the MacBook Pro lasts longer because it's able to complete those same tasks faster and more efficiently. Both MacBooks come with chargers. The MacBook Air comes with either a 35 watt dual USB-C port charger or a 70 watt single port power adapter. And the MacBook Pro comes with a 67 watt adapter, which can be upgraded to 96 watt adapter for $20. And that brings me to the price. So in the US, the base MacBook Air versus the base MacBook Pro, we're looking at $1,299 versus $1,999. That $700 is a lot of money. But the base MacBook Air comes with 8 gigs of unified memory and 256 gigabytes of internal storage, and the MacBook Pro comes with 16 and 512. Now, if you wanted to compare apples to apples, you're adding $400 to the MacBook Air for a total of $1,700, and now it's only a $300 difference. Remember that you can't upgrade the unified memory or the internal storage after you make your purchase. You can supplement storage with an external SSD or with cloud storage, but make sure that you have enough room for the files and apps that you need to store locally. Right now, everything that comes with the MacBook Air takes up about 35 gigabytes of storage, which leaves you more than 200 gigs of free space. If you are already going to upgrade the MacBook Air to 16 and 512, then you need to ask yourself, am I better off getting a thinner and slightly lighter device with a larger display, a bigger trackpad, and better battery life? Or am I better off in the long run with a smaller but better quality display, more ports, more convenient port locations, more types of ports, faster Wi-Fi 6E compatibility, and better external display support? In which case, it would make sense to consider the base 14-inch MacBook Pro even if you don't really need the additional performance at this time. You should definitely look at refurbished 14-inch M2 MacBook Pros, which you can get for $1,699, which is exactly the same price as the upgraded MacBook Air. And if you don't need the latest and greatest processor, I think what might be the best value is an M1 14-inch MacBook Pro for even less. Now you should see how the 14-inch MacBook Pro compares with the 16. Click on my face to subscribe. You know what I always say? Buy it nice or buy it twice. Good luck and see you soon.